This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Sports Files is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Tonight, we'll talk to Memphis's own Barrett Jones, an offensive lineman at the University of Alabama who lived through the Tuscaloosa tornado. Our bizarre and tragic spring continued over the weekend with the horrifying story of a massive tornado wrecking the town of Joplin, Missouri. The death toll from that tornado has risen to well over 100. Our hearts and prayers go out to the entire community. Tonight's guest knows what they're going through in Joplin because less than a month ago, he went through a very similar experience. Barrett Jones is a graduate of ECS and is now an accomplished offensive lineman at the University of Alabama. He won a national championship at Alabama, and he blocked for the school's first Heisman Trophy winner. But when Barrett reflects back on his college memories 20 or 30 years from now, it's hard to imagine that any will be more vivid than the memories that were seared into his brain on April 27th in Tuscaloosa. He watched the tornado from his apartment window. He saw a town he has grown to love torn apart. But he saw, too, the way that community pulled together to begin the arduous task of rebuilding. I'll ask him about all of that. Before I do, though, let me say one quick thing about Barrett. I'll say it now because I don't want to embarrass him when he joins me on the set. The kid is pure gold. He's everything you wish big-time college athletes could be. He's smart, he's thoughtful, he's generous, and he's keenly aware that the world doesn't revolve around him. But don't take my word for it. See for yourself. His name is Barrett Jones, and he's coming up next. As promised, Barrett Jones joins me now. Barrett, thank you very much for being on the show.
Yes, sir. Thanks for having
offensive
me.
Offensive lineman at Alabama and played at ECS. Is that right?
You played at ECS.
I want to have you here for all kinds of reasons. One of them is to discuss your violin career, which we were discussing before the show began. But no, the first one obviously is because you were part of witness to and then part of the cleanup for one of the great tragedies this region has suffered in recent years, and that is the tornado. Tell me if you can. You're here, obviously, grateful to be in one piece. Can you sum it up? What was it like?
It was the most bizarre experience I've ever been a part of. I've obviously never seen a tornado before, and you know, you always hear the sirens, and you always hear things on the news, and I guess you just don't really believe them until you actually see it out your window. And that's actually what happened to me. They had been talking to...
We have a photo here, and I'm going to ask them, they're going to put it up now, a photo of you, of what you saw out your window, so people can see what you're talking about. This is literally what you saw out your window. Are you terrified at that moment?
I was extremely terrified. I think more so for the people I knew it was hitting. I could see it kind of moving from right to left across my horizon. So I had a good idea it wasn't going to hit me because it was moving away from me when I was seeing it. But I think I was just more terrified because, you know, I had seen enough things like that on TV to know that that kind of tornado does, you know, terrible damage. So I was, I guess it was just a real surreal feeling watching
knowing that bad things
were happening. People's houses were being destroyed, and in some cases, people were probably losing their lives.
Is it... You know, we deal with sirens here. You grew up in Memphis, you hear sirens all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I confess, I am somewhat you hear them? Right. I've never been hit by a tornado. You know, you figure it's happening to someone else.
I'm the same way.
Is it that morning? Was there a sense that something different was happening or going to happen in Tuscaloosa? Or was it, sirens, that, same stuff?
Well, there was a sense that something different was happening. And I think that's because they actually did a really good job of warning us kind of about what was going to happen, they thought. Our teachers were telling us that the National Weather Service checks on 25 conditions for tornadic weather. And apparently this storm was the first one in history that had all 25 conditions that meant that a tornado was probably going to arise. So they'd actually already canceled night classes and canceled a lot of things because they knew that there's going to be really bad weather. So I think it was a little different just because we've been talking about it all week this day. And, you know, but still, it really just didn't sink in until, you know, I saw it. And once you saw it, you just realized, wow, this is real.
And you saw it, there is literally the calm before the storm. Is that,
definitely.
Take me through it a little bit.
Well, I mean, it's just the weather was outside. It was great that day. You know, it was nice and cool and with a nice breeze. And so, you know, I was like, well, there's not bad weather. It hadn't rained all day. And so, yeah, it was great. It was a little windy, but not bad. And then, you know, we're watching the weather, and James Spann, that's the name of the weather guy in Birmingham that does Tuscaloosa too. He was saying that it was headed right for Tuscaloosa. You know, still, you're not really believing it. But then he showed the shot of the tornado actually coming towards Tuscaloosa on the, you know, SkyCam that's right. Located in downtown Tuscaloosa. And so you could see the tornado coming towards Tuscaloosa right at downtown on the SkyCam. And that's when I was like, this is real. You know, we need right. to probably take cover or something. And then right after that, the power went off. So that kind of complicates things, because then you're like, I don't know where it is. I don't have a picture of it anymore. So that's when I went and looked on my balcony and I saw it.
And is it? It was the widest in person. I mean, you think of a tornado as this little. This was a wall.
Oh, it was more. It was over a half mile wide. I mean, it really looks from the sky angle like you have Tuscaloosa here is a lawn, and it looks like somebody just took a lawnmower and just wiped out a strip. I mean, it's absurd because, you know, one structure right here will be fine, and the next structure will just be gone. It's really the craziest.
So did you go, I know I read stories about you being part of the cleanup the next day in Alabama. Lots of Nick Saban was out there and lots of people. How is your, I mean, obviously this is your home, but that's your other home.
Right.
How is Tuscaloosa?
Tuscaloosa is on the road to recovery. I think it's been unbelievable the response we've seen. I think the FEMA people there were so complimentary of Tuscaloosa, saying that more work got done in one day than got done in 3 or 4 weeks in New Orleans, just because everyone there is helping. It really is amazing to see the response of the people there, because I think everyone that lives in Tuscaloosa loves the city. And, you know, I think they the longest lines in Tuscaloosa right now haven't been the homeless shelter lines. They've been the volunteer lines. There's been so many people wanting to volunteer, and there hadn't been that many people in the shelters because you know, people's neighbors are taking them in. It's right. great to see. And, you know, I think that's the kind of attitude we need to take. You know, we have two choices. We can either sit around and be disappointed about it, or we can, you know, try to make the best of the situation. And I think there's really a surprising positive attitude there
right.
and kind of a attitude of hope.
You had a teammate who was thrown from a building and whose girlfriend died. Is that right?
That's
is
right. That, mm-hmm.
How was he? What is he?
Yeah, that's Carson Tinker. And He's going to be all right, I think. He actually was thrown 75 yards. And that's 3/4 of a football field, obviously. And that's so
right.
far. I mean, can't imagine. He was actually in a closet with his girlfriend, and they were picked up by the storm and thrown 75 yards. They found him in a field across from her house. And he had extreme concussion. I think he hurt his wrist as well. But it was really a miracle that he was otherwise fine.
So one of the stories that has emerged from this is obviously – all we hear about, and I started my newspaper career in Anniston, Alabama. I covered Auburn for Anniston, Alabama, for the Anniston Star. And so I know how fierce it is down there. But we hear about the trees getting killed and the Feinbaum show, people throwing this, you know, the verbal back and forth,
right.
the nastiness, the ferocity, the craziness that is Alabama Auburn. One of the things that sort of come out of this is this sense of pulling together, which you right. often get. But have you noticed? I mean, first of all, how bad was that nastiness from your perspective? And then has there been how does it strike you when you're in the midst of it?
Right. First of all, the nastiness, I think, what most people don't realize is how small of a portion of each fan base
yes.
those people are. You know, I mean,
one loony poisoning trees.
Right.
Can tar the, yes, it's
right.
exactly.
And I think every Auburn person would admit there's some crazy Auburn people out there.
Clearly.
Too. So I think, you know, they maybe are the ones that speak up the loudest. And, you know, so that's why we always think of them when we think of the fans.
Well, and they're given a megaphone, too. But, right. I mean, the Paul Feinbaum's show is a right. megaphone because it trades in, and he does a great job at what he does, being a newsman slash carnival barker. But those characters are what make his show interesting.
It, and it so really they are given a megaphone. It is very entertaining. So, yeah.
Do you listen to the Feinbaum show?
I do. I listen to it occasionally.
Do you go on it?
I've been on it once.
You've been on it once.
But I mean,
it's highly entertaining.
Never call it, you know, I have to have permission.
You don't call it.
No, not like that. I have to have permission.
But it's like, I mean, it is. It's highly entertaining. So anyway, it's a small group.
It's a small portion. I think most of the fans, you know, have a better perspective on life, that there is more important things than rivalries. And while the rivalry is an important part of the state, and I think it's, you know, at times it can be healthy and good for the state, you know, in times like this, you know, that's really the last thing on most people's mind, I think. And, you know, I've seen a ton of Auburn people up in Tuscaloosa helping you know, just doing what they can because they realize that, you know, human lives and human homes, you know, are so far outweigh, you know, a rivalry. And I think that's what most people don't realize around the country is that, you know, we really do love our neighbors, I guess you could say. It's just
And they are your neighbors.
They are. They're our neighbors. And, you know, it's just that it's fun to have a good heated rivalry, and I think most people take it the right way, you know, but you do have those few people that...
Well, and maybe it's not so much that hearts and minds are changed by this tragedy as much as it is that the few loonies who come to define a rivalry when there's no tragedy,
right.
no one has time for them anymore. And
right.
just the good, decent people who really mm-hmm. are part of the Auburn community and the Alabama
right.
community emerge, and that's who you notice... doing the hard work.
I think that's definitely right. And if you've listened to Feinbaum at all this week, you hear those people calling in and talking, you know, no matter where they're from, about just, you know, their best hopes and prayers are with Tuscaloosa. And I think it's been great just to see those people reaching out. And like you said, just, you know, realizing that there's more important things.
Will this football season be different, do you think, because of people's memories of this tornado?
I think it definitely will. I think it's going to leave a lasting imprint on Tuscaloosa. I mean, if you've seeing pictures of the damage, it's 10 times worse than you could imagine. It honestly is the craziest thing you've ever seen. It looks like something out of a movie. It looks like Twister. You know, those cities you see in Twister destroyed, that's how it looks. And I just don't think I believe that or really understood that a tornado really could do that until you see it for yourself. And it becomes real to you when you see it in your own backyard. And I definitely
so
think it's
will
really
be known
imprint.
As a season of recovery and of... Do you believe that football can heal? I mean, do you believe that it does that, or do you just think it provides a place where people... I don't know. What's the role of the football team in that?
Right. Well, I think this has been a great chance for the football team to show to Tuscaloosa that we're part of the community. And, you know, whatever we can do, just because, you know, we do mean so much to the community, whether that's right or not, you know, I feel like we have a real opportunity to help out. And, you know, just going around with some of the football players, it's been great, you know, just to see people's smile. And I'm not trying to make us sound good. I'm just saying,
no.
You know, we want to do what we can. And if it's going to make people who lost their homes happy, you know, for us coming out there and helping them and encouraging them, then that's what we want to do. And like I said, we really just want to show that we're a part of this community just like they are.
You're only here in order to enable to do the show, and I appreciate you coming in, because literally you're the rest of the school year was canceled. Practically, I mean, you're even though you are, in fact, coming to the end of your third year there, or just finished your third year there, you're ready to graduate and get a master's, is my understanding. What practically happened? Everything's called off? Whatever grade you had?
Right.
What's happened down there?
Practically, if you're happy with your grade, you take it. And if you're not, then you can reschedule your exam, but it's going to be either late May or early June in the summer when you have to come back and take it.
And you'll go back for the summer
right.
at some point?
I'm going back. Summer school is right now on, so I'll start summer school May 31st.
I got you. And you'll be back there doing that.
Yeah, and this university is open too now. But I think, you know, what people don't realize, they think, well, it didn't hit campus, but it hit so many students' homes. It hit so many teachers' homes that lived right around that area. Actually, my accounting teacher, I know, lived right in an area that was just blown away. It's called Forest Lake, if you're looking at pictures. And she lived right there, and thankfully she's all right. But, I mean, everything she owns is gone. And I think, you know, giving an exam is probably the last thing she's thinking about. You know, I think it would just be impossible to continue on.
You went, and it's interesting because you've been part of this tragedy, and yet for the last 2 years, I think, you've been to Haiti to do relief work there.
Right.
I suspect when you're in Haiti, you think, well, this is awful, but it's in Haiti. It, can you relate one to the other?
That's a great point. I think the first thing about Haiti is when I saw the earthquake damage there when I went a few months after the disaster, I think I thought to myself, you know, I'll never see anything like this again. And that's where I'm wrong, because I saw something just as equal in Tuscaloosa and just as terrible. On the other hand, like you asked, I think it does really give you perspective. It is more real, and whether that's right or wrong, you know, it's more real when it's happening to people you know, and when people you talk to, their homes are gone. And you know, like I said, you see it on the news, and even if you go there and see it, you know, it is sad, and you do, you know, get emotional about all those people that lost their homes, but. You know, you get more emotional when it's people you know and it's in your own backyard. Right.
And yet, because it happens to people you know, it probably works the other way, too, that you realize now more what the folks in Haiti are. You mentioned the difference between the Tuscaloosa. It's not that Haiti, people in Haiti don't want to pull together and make it. I suspect it's just an infrastructure issue there. Does it feel helpless? How much you went back? Mm-hmm. How much better was it a year later than it was the first time you went?
You know, it was a little better. But I guess not as better as we want it to be, you know. And I think Tuscaloosa has been really a textbook example of how to handle a disaster like this. You know, we've had all kind of organizations in there, and people are, you know, all have food, all have a place to live, you know, from everything I've heard. And I think they've really done a great job of managing this situation the best they could. I know the mayor, Walt Maddox, has done a great job at organizing everything. And, you know, whereas in Haiti, I'm just not sure they had that leadership in place to handle something like this. And
how is it that you came to go to Haiti? And we have this image of football players as large, hulking people who wouldn't be able to tell you who the mayor of I mean, that's the stereotype,
right.
And you know it. How is it that you came to go to Haiti?
Well, you know, I don't know. I just, I've really been praying about it a lot, and I just felt God put on my heart that he wanted me to go somewhere, and I didn't know where. You know, I felt like I really wanted to do some mission work, and so I started praying about it, and a few days later, this happened in Haiti, you know, the earthquake. And I think the earthquake was either late January or February. Mm-hmm. And I was, you know, I was like, this is amazing. You know, God really put on my heart, that's where I want you to go. And, you know, but everyone was telling me, you know, no chance you can get into Haiti right now. The airport's closed because, you know, the government's running it. Only government personnel can get in. You know, just don't even worry about trying because it's impossible.
So this wasn't some program that was out there that
no.
said, hey, Barrett, we really could use you here as a token football
right.
player. This was literally started from your desire to do it.
It did. And I tell you what, God just worked it out because actually a local missionary, his name's Soup Campbell. We called him and he had been many times. And, you know, he was really interested in wanting to help us. And I took two of my really good friends with me. And we went and we flew in the Dominican Republic. We actually had to drive into Haiti. And it actually was I think it was a 9-hour drive, and it was in the back of a truck. So that was the hardest 9 hours of my entire life. It was in the back of a truck.
Tougher than training
with no asphalt. So
oh my God!
It was
all
intense.
Right. They tell me I have about 5 minutes here left. So I want to hit a variety of topics real
okay.
quick, and we'll even talk some football too.
Okay.
You played some left tackle. You're a guard. You typically, although you were tackle at ECS, I think.
Yes, I was.
Played left tackle for Alabama. Are you in the spring? Are you going to play left tackle? Or are you going to play guard?
That's a great question.
you wish you knew the answer.
I played guard most of the spring, but then at the very end I played in left tackle and actually played left tackle in the spring game. So I'm not sure at this point, but I'll really play wherever I can, and I just really want to help the team, and you know I want to win another championship, and I think that's the attitude around Alabama right now. So if that's left tackle, if that's right guard, whatever.
So you obviously lost a lot in the draft. Marcel Darius goes. Julia Jones goes, Mark Ingram goes, there's another
James
first
Carpenter.
One. James Carpenter goes, the other yeah. left tackle.
Yeah.
And so the opening goes.
Right.
Is there talent there to have a special year?
Oh, there's definitely talent. We have a ton of talent, and you know, I think we could have a similar year to that next year in the draft. But obviously that's not our goal right now, is to get drafted. Our goal is to have another great year. And you know, we definitely have all the talent to do it. It's really right now about leadership, and I think that's what we didn't have as much of last year, is we didn't have great leadership, and I think that's what we're working on this year, is really starting it from the inside. And I think you know, the coaches can yell at you all you want, but until your team really takes it on themselves to be great and not accept anything less than greatness, you know, that's when you're really gonna have a great team.
Is Greg McElroy gonna be an NFL quarterback? I mean, what's your sense?
I think he will be. I think he's extremely smart. You know, he's one of the smartest guys you'll ever be around. So I think that helps him, because he knows everything you know, that's going to happen before it happens, and he studies film so hard. I think that's a big part of it, you know, the mental part of the NFL, from what I hear.
Difference in blocking for Mark Ingram and Trent Richardson?
I get asked this question a lot, and I don't, there's no difference.
I hate to ask the cliche questions.
No,
but, you know,
no.
We're getting down to the end. No, I'm just kidding.
No,
Or are you just doing your job?
Yeah, I don't even know who's in the game most of the time, to be honest with you. I don't even know who's in the game. Occasionally I'll notice who's in the huddle, but for so long that both those guys have been so good, you know, you can't really even tell the difference until, you know, when you feel Trent run to the back of you, he's maybe a little more powerful, you know, when he just shoulders you. He's actually the strongest person
really?
I've ever seen in my entire life. I mean, the guy,
Trent is.
The guy can just, you can put as much weight in the squat bar as you want. I've never seen him struggle. Never seen him even struggle with any weight in the weight room. He's a freak athlete.
Is this your last year? Are you going to, you could actually play for, because you were a red shirt. You're going to be getting a master's this year in
right.
your senior year,
mm-hmm.
but you could technically play
two more years,
although there were rumors, you know, like everyone always get is Barrett going to go pro after this year? Do you know?
I have no idea.
One game at a time?
One
this is where you go with the cliche, one game at a time, one season at a time.
Definitely,
answer.
One season at a time. No, but in all seriousness, it is one season at a time, and I really have no idea. And I think I just want to make the best decision for me and my family and also for the team. And Coach Saban is great about this. You know, he's not pushy about it. He's very realistic. And, you know, he'll sit me down at the end of the season and talk about – he'll call coaches because he has a lot of great relationships with GMs and coaches, which is great to have. And, you know, get a realistic picture of if I did go, where I'd be taken. And, if another year could help me.
How is he different than what we think he is, Nick Saban?
He's very different than what we picture him. Now, he is that intense guy on the field, and he's extremely intense and, accepts nothing less than greatness, which I think is why we have been great in the past. But at the same time, you know, he's joking and he's fun at times. And every day when I'm stretching, he comes by and finds a way to make fun of me in some way. you know, messes with me.
Right.
For some reason, I think I'm an easy target. He always has something to say to me about somebody who, you know, I look slow on some plays today or something.
Well, let's give him some material. Last question is, tell me about your violin career. They threw up a graphic there saying you were a 10-year Suzuki-trained violinist.
Right. I'm still kind of wanting to know how the guys in your research department found that
We've got a crack. I think it involved your father,
okay.
Rex, who, by the way, he played basketball at Alabama.
He did, at Alabama.
And he may have been the snitch. So
he probably was. He loves to tell people that. And, you know, I'm being honest with you, I've done a really good job this far
of hiding it,
of hiding that from the Alabama media.
Well, they won't ever see this show.
Okay.
I'm sure on YouTube they'll never get a hold
right.
of this show. And you've never been asked about
I've been kind of keeping it under the rug, and you know, I'm waiting for the right time to pull it out, kind of the ace in the hole. But you know, I think that is true. I played for 10 years, and I played for a long time, and really
you played weddings.
Yeah, I did. I played at weddings, and I played in groups and nursing homes, and just kind of all over the place. And it was a great part of my life, but eventually, I was playing so many competitive sports that I had to decide that I had to either choose sports or violin. And, you know, I felt like I made a good decision.
Well, Barrett, you've been awfully great to join us. Thanks very much. We wish you the best in this
year.
It was a lot of fun. And thanks very much.
Yes, sir.
All right, we will be back in a moment with the wrap. So for tonight's wrap, I give you a letter from someone named Jeremy Graves. The letter went like this. Dear Geoff, last week, as a joke, I sent in my resume for the third assistant coaching position at the University of Memphis. I have a great resume for Ernst & Young, not so much for college basketball. I honestly expected nothing back and figured best case scenario, I get a form letter saying I'd been turned down. Wednesday, my cell phone rings and it's Josh Pastner calling me to let me know he appreciates my interest, but they already have a few people in mind for the job. Who does that? What does he get out of it other than making a fan's day? I will always be a Tigers fan, and now I will be a Josh Pastner fan as well. Sincerely, Jeremy Graves. Well, Jeremy, that's Josh Pastner for you. And it's another reason I wouldn't be too concerned that Pastner has now lost two assistant coaches off last year's staff. Glenn Ciprian announced Friday that he'll be taking a job as an assistant at Texas A&M. Willis Wilson had previously announced that he'd be moving on. The loss of Cyprian in particular could be seen as a bit of a blow to the Tigers. Glenn was a proven recruiter and is the man most responsible for bringing the Barton brothers to town. But Josh Pastner isn't exactly a slouch as a recruiter either. He'll find someone who can do the job. In the meantime, well, if he can make anonymous fan like Jeremy Graves feel that spectacular, imagine what he can do for a player or a coach that he wants to see join the team. And that's the show for this week. Remember, to follow us on Facebook or Twitter, go to WKNO.org and click on WKNO Tonight. Until next time, Roll Tide.